Hello, and welcome to yet another exciting episode of Academic Insights session into biotechnology. By 2025, the biotechnology industry is predicted to have an annual turnover of around $1 trillion. The sector will play a key role in global vaccine market. From Australia's perspective, excellent research and teaching facilities, world-class scientists, and a strong regulatory body have made Australia a powerhouse of biotechnology innovation. Australia is home to more than 417 biotech companies. Having said that, from India's perspective, do we know enough about biotechnology? Do we understand the opportunities we have in front of us? To share insights on biotechnology and the programs students can opt for, we have amongst us today Associate Professor Mark Green from the University of Melbourne. He's an expert in reproductive biology and have won many awards for his contribution in the stream. University of Melbourne itself is ranked number one in the biomedical sciences in Australia, and globally it's ranked amongst top 40 universities in the world. Established in 1853, the University of Melbourne is one of the oldest universities of Australia, and it is also ranked seventh worldwide for graduate employability. With this, we would like to welcome our guest on board and thank him for being a part of this panel discussion. Welcome, Professor Mark.
Thanks, no problem. Great to be here.
Thanks a lot. And we can straight away move into our discussion for our viewers. And Professor Mark, since the topic of today's discussion is biotechnology, what is biotechnology for our viewers to understand?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question, actually, because it means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. So biotechnology really is about us utilizing our knowledge of the environment and the world around us and our biology to really inform new processes and products that we can develop for our own benefit in terms of maybe medical diagnostics or agri-food, healthcare. There are many avenues that we can use our biology knowledge, and really biotechnology encompasses all of that.
Right. Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. And with this, I would like to throw my next question to you, and it's around the academic standards. So when it comes to biotechnology, how do academics engage with biotech industry in Australia, especially from the University of Melbourne's perspective? And is it only restricted to Australia, or it is widened across the world?
Okay, yeah, so that's another great question. So in terms of our involvement, then, as you've stated in your introduction, then the University of Melbourne is ranked number one in Australia. And so we are very much at the research forefront. So like myself and many of the other academics throughout the university, we're always engaging with industry, whether it's in doing commercial contracts, for example, or developing new products. And so it's very common for our research to be heavily engaged in the interface between industry and academia. So it isn't just about doing academic research. It really is about translation of our science out there. So it's really important. Equally, it's not with just companies based in Australia. Many of us have relationships with multinational companies. So I was previously sponsored by Merck Serono from Germany, for example. So a lot of companies continue to invest in the University of Melbourne, and we have some very strong relationships.
Well, that's a great thing for our viewers to understand, because that will give them the opportunity to engage with industry once they graduate. So, Professor Mark, since we are talking about biotechnology, and I would like to focus particularly on one program called Masters of Biotechnology. So what will students study in a program like Masters of Biotechnology, and how is it going to help them?
Yeah, so that's really our master's program has developed over the years. We've had this established now for probably in excess of 12 years, and it's been highly successful. The key, I think, point of difference for our program is that it's a 200-point program in which you can study a number of subjects. And we really put it in the fact that the core subjects sit around upskilling those students that go through this program in terms of their commercialization knowledge, leadership in science, project management, all of the key assets that you'll need to do well in any industry. And then you get to choose from a number of other electives. So those include those in the sciences. So you can do anything in sort of biotechnology or gene or any kind of science that you actually engage with. Alongside that, you'll also get to choose with some professional skills. It might be in financial accounting or management or communication. And so we try and put together a really rounded package that's tailored to you as an individual. So we give you a lot of scope to, I guess, pick your own journey based on where you would like to end up. But our point of difference really sits around the flagship in our program, and that is our industry program. So we have an industry project where you're based with one of these international companies for a year as a consultant working on real life problems. And that really is where we set ourselves apart from other programs.
Right. Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. And it's a great insight. So on the same perspective, talking about Masters of Biotechnology, our students would like to understand what are the key entry requirements for a student who is interested in studying Masters of Biotechnology? What are the key entry points? What are the academic perspective prerequisites of what he needs to achieve to get into a program like Masters of Biotechnology in the University of Melbourne?
Yeah, so we accept students into the program that have an average mark through their undergraduate program in about 65 equivalent here in Australia. And they can come from a huge variety of backgrounds because, as I said, biotech is many shapes and sizes. So it can be everything from agricultural sciences, for example, to pharmacy or chemistry. So we've really opened it right up because we understand that there are many different companies out there. So it really is anything in the sort of fundamental sciences. And then we're looking for just a minimum requirement of that 65 entry. And obviously, if you've got other studies in there, then that's great. So anything above 65 is making sure that you can come to the program.
Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. I think that's a good takeaway for our students who are listening to us right now, that the entry point to get into a program like Masters of Technology, Biotechnology, is 65% in your undergrad studies. So with this, I would like to move into my next question. How students can put their skills into practice when they study this particular program? Are there any internship opportunities available for students?
Yes, absolutely. That is absolutely the core focus for us in terms of the outcomes and the objectives of running this program. It's very much about putting things in practice. And so, as I spoke to you about earlier, so the industry project that we run for the year long, what we have is that we have different projects where companies such as Merck or Roche or big pharmaceutical companies, as well as small startups here in Australia, they'll put forward a project that is a real world project in terms of a brief. And then you're working as a consultant for a year in that company with the people around the world. The great thing about Zoom, as we're seeing now, is that we're allowed to engage with people right around the globe. So historically, we've worked with people in Australia, but now we're looking for companies with offices in Singapore, in India, Malaysia, for example. And so we do actually have a huge global network there. So it is absolutely about you then using those skills that we've taught you in things such as project management, for example, or leadership in science, working in small teams as you would do in real life situations in the office, combined between your team and the team that's in that company, and fulfilling the brief that they've set you in terms of either doing background innovation on a project or a product that they're putting forward. And so that is just that one aspect that we can do for this key project. Alongside that, then students also get the opportunity to do extra internships. So that one's for a year, and that's, of course, the core part of our course. But they can also choose to do an internship at other companies or other industries, whether it's one that they choose completely, and that's for a whole semester. In addition, they can also choose to do a research internship. So they may come and work in my lab, for example, or any of the labs across the University of Melbourne, everything from green energy all the way through to agribiotech. So there's lots of opportunity to do internships, whether it's in science or actually in the industry itself.
Okay. Professor Mark, interestingly, you spoke about the fact that students are coming from diverse backgrounds and they can get into various streams after studying this particular program. So can you throw some light on the different projects students have worked on in past and how it really helps them?
Yeah, so great. So we definitely have a diverse range of students. We're very well known internationally. So we're drawing from obviously India, Asia, and across South America as well. We have a number of graduates coming in, so as well as Australian students. The kind of projects that you would be doing, and they're really brand new each year. It's very much about what that company would like to do. But historically, we've had a lot of biopharmaceutical projects from CSL, for example. So looking at vaccines, for example, looking at their diagnostics, some kidney dialysis work, for example. There's other ones where they have looked at new literature searches to look at a product or scoping it in terms of the market that's available for it. So we can be everywhere from agribiotech, could be more pesticides, sprays, it could be all sorts of other things. So huge diversity. We tend to put the projects in four sort of buckets. So that's sort of agri-food, medical diagnostics, the regulation and quality assurance, for example. So they can be any of the big companies that we're dealing with. And we're always growing the number of companies that we work with every year.
Right. Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. And I'm just moving away from this topic for a while. What made you get into biotechnology? What is so special about biotechnology?
I guess for me, it's about, obviously, I'm a trained scientist, so I like to try and make sure that my science is applicable and for translation back in the real world. And that's really what's driven me towards biotech. So personally, my research has led to starting up two spin-out companies, which I've been a director of. I hold a number of patents on technologies that I've introduced, and I currently work with a number of companies as well. So I really engage that interface there, and I really enjoy that very much, as well as the teaching aspect. So for me, this is a perfect role. It combines my love of reproductive biology and biotechnology. And so as the director, I've really enjoyed this. And that's the same for a lot of our academics. So we are lucky in the sense that we have many scientists and academics that teach into the program, but we actually have a lot of people from industry who've worked for 20 to 30 years in regulatory affairs or legislation, and they are the people that are actually teaching the course as well. So we rely very heavily on industry to provide lecturers as well, so you understand that it's not just an academic viewpoint on that.
Well, I think it's a great amalgamation where you have people from the industry, you have people from academics, and students can get to know the real life experiences of you guys and how they can tackle problems. So I think it's a big plus for students.
And I think it's very useful that most of the academics that come here and most of the industry as well that come here often lead to the connections after that lecture, after that tutorial. And those are the people that they sometimes go and work with. And same way that when they're doing the industry project, there's a number of companies that have hired the people that have actually worked with them as consultants. So it's very common for us to be recruiting out to the companies that engage with us in that space. So it's a great win for the industry because they get the best and the brightest from the University of Melbourne. And they really do rely on us as a recruitment source.
Cool. That's good to hear. And Professor Mark, coming back to biotechnology, our students in India are very interested in knowing the career opportunities they can pursue once they mm-hmm. graduate. So what are the kind of industries and the organizations students usually work with once they graduate with biotech degree?
Yes, I think coming to mind, first of all, would probably be the big companies like Merck or Roche or GSK, so the big pharmaceuticals. But we have lots of people that go into the regulatory biotech industry, quality assurance for many firms, some of the new startup companies. They might go into some of the pesticide companies. They might go into some of the IT companies. We have a lot of project management. Obviously, in the training in the core is looking at project management. From that, a lot of people choose sometimes not to go per se into biotechnology, but they take those skills into banking or into big telecommunication firms. So it doesn't matter, almost in a way, that the training is so applicable to many, many industries. But we have such great success with people in the biotech space that it's very easy to get a job. And what we're pushing now is that for people coming from different countries, that we're trying to engage with companies, specifically the international companies that have hubs in Mumbai, for example. And so they can actually run companies. So when you get back into your home country, it is that you have that network established. And so hopefully it leads to a job once you get back home as well.
I have a connecting question, Professor Mark, and this is related to what we are going through these days. With COVID being around, do you see that biotech industry growing in future as well? And we have seen companies like Pfizer, AstraZeneca, Johnson & Johnson coming up, and now more and more people know about these companies. So do you think that COVID will play as a catalyst to biotech?
Yeah, I mean, it was already, from the stats that you put in the introduction there, it's already a growing area in terms of the companies that are growing in that sort of biopharmaceutical space. And so, yes, something like COVID and the pandemic is good for business, not necessarily for us, I guess, to have all the lockdowns and things, but it is absolutely good in terms of the pharmaceutical industry and the vaccines. I mean, I wish I bought shares in Pfizer and AstraZeneca at this point. But so, yeah, I think it is absolutely, it's going to go like that from strength to strength. And so a job in this arena means that you're set for life, I think.
I think you're absolutely right. With the way the biotech industry is growing, I think the future is bright. And of course, COVID has played as a catalyst to that. And now more and more people would like to get into biotech industry. So thanks a lot for sharing insights on that. It was a right quick session. But for our viewers who are watching us live, if you still have any questions and you would like to speak to Professor Mark or University of Melbourne at large, you can always connect with us at the IDP Australian Virtual Fair, which is currently going on, and it's been organized in all the cities in India. So you can connect with the University of Melbourne there, and we can always wish you best of luck for any career insights, for any program insights. You can always get in touch with us. With this, we have reached the end of our discussion. So anything you would like to say, Professor Mark, as a closing note to our viewers?
I think I'd just like to echo your sentiments. If you've got any questions, we're more than happy and here at the University of Melbourne to receive any email inquiries at the team there. And hopefully, get into LinkedIn. You'll see all of the people that have graduated through our course and where they are now. And that is the best network for getting jobs in the future. So we look forward to seeing you here at the University of Melbourne.
Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. And for our viewers, we would always encourage you to stay connected with IDP Education for the updates from Australia. This would help you in making an informed decision. So with this, we have reached the end of our discussion. And I would like to thank Professor Mark for taking time out and being a part of this panel discussion, and all our viewers who are watching us live. So thank you, Professor Mark, for all your time.
No problem. Thanks for letting me be here. Thanks.
Thanks a lot, Professor Mark. Stay tuned, guys. Stay healthy. Stay safe. Thank you for watching us.